Hey everybody, welcome back to my channel. I am your girl, Psych Time TV2, and thank you so much for watching. We are going to talk about SummerSlam and everything that I thought. Now, if you want to know my thoughts and my little funny take on SummerSlam and some other topics, please, please go over to my boy AT2. He has a wonderful after party or after show that myself and my podcast partner and friend Nicole was a part of, and one of my favorite content creators on Instagram, WrestleShade, was there along with V Fox. We all five of us had a great time yesterday. We talked for 3 hours. Of course, I talked the most because child, I talk a lot. But anyways, so here we go. Basically, my overall thoughts of SummerSlam was that I thought that it was a great show. It felt over the top. It was great. It gave you that feeling of pay-per-view again. It gave you that feeling of wrestling again. And that's what we've been missing longer than these COVID quarantine times. We've been missing that for a while. And I think what happened with this virus and the pandemic hitting the way that it did, it really forced all of us to go back to, you know, the old days of wrestling, where you had to have great characters, over the top antics, pyro, and just, you know, all of the things that made wrestling cool to us when we were kids. You know what I mean? And they went right back to it. And I think that it helped them kind of revive where they should be putting their money and their time into, and not just sitting there and saying, okay, we've got great wrestlers, it doesn't matter what we put on, they'll enjoy it, they'll watch it. They're really taking their time to understand that the production and the over-the-top antics is what makes people fall in love with WWE. That is WWE. So when what we got with this Thunderdome is our wrestling back. So I have to give them props for that. Also give them props for doing this pay-per-view and trying to make it as massive as possible and keeping it down to 2-3 hours, I want to say. Because we got done at about 10. SummerSlam started at 7. So they cut matches very short, but we still got the meat and potatoes of a lot of things. So let's start with the first match. It happened on the pre-show, which I'm very thankful for. It was MVP versus Apollo Crews. Now, my pick for this was Apollo Crews, 100%. And the reason why I picked Apollo Crews is because, one, he deserves to have a decent title reign. Number two, MVP is not the right wrestler to compete against Apollo Crews, if you ask me, or compete, period. I think that MVP definitely needs to be the guy who is a mouthpiece and not necessarily a fighter or a title holder. It is better for him to be your manager / valet type of guy who occasionally involves himself in a match or two. And, you know, kind of like a Zelina Vega, where they can wrestle, but they just, maybe they shouldn't, you know. So, basically, Apollo Crews won. And I'm very happy for Apollo Crews. I'm glad he looked great. You know, he had a big smile on his face. And when it came time to get in that work, he got in that work. So I'm very, very proud of Apollo Crews, and I'm very happy for him. He's got a great theme now. He's really into his character. So I'm excited to see what he can bring to the table, and I'm very excited to see who his next opponent is, as long as it ain't nobody from the Hurt Business. Okay, so let's move on into the next match, or the very first match of the night for SummerSlam. So the first match of the night was Bayley versus Asuka, and I was very invested in this match because my choice for the winner was for Asuka to win this title match. I really wanted her to win, to compete, to be champion, and I wanted her to best Bayley for sure. Now, what happened in this match was Bayley ended up winning, but for the most part, this match was a true battle. Asuka dominated Bayley for the better part of the match. Bayley then ended up getting some get back by injuring Asuka's knee, and she attacked her knee and was taking her down. Now, this was a turning point in this match because it gave Bayley the upper hand. And for the better part of this match, you saw Bayley is beyond capable in terms of her wrestling skill, and she was able to put on a solid match for this show with Asuka. She competed toe-to-toe, but Asuka was able to turn it around, and she still had her number. At every chance she got, she was either kicking out or countering something that Bayley was doing. So it was very difficult, but Bayley was able to keep up. Now, the turning point was when Sasha got involved. Sasha came into the match as a factor pretty much in the middle when Bayley was really hitting her low stride. Sasha started, you know, to taunt Asuka, laughing in her face when Bayley would get the upper hand. She caused a lot of mischief and, you know, eerie and worry when it came to this match as to what she was going to do. Now, what she did was she tried to interfere several times, swiping at Asuka, you know, yelling at her or, you know, taunting her. And in this last interference, Bayley was on the top of on the ropes, and Asuka was getting ready to basically boot her. I mean, not boot her, but like, you know, booty bumper. And what happened was Sasha got up, moved Bayley out of the way, and took the hit for her. And that was how Bayley was able to win on a roll-up. this roll-up in turn gave Bayley her, you know, her one win over Asuka in the last three matches that they've had. Now, after that was done and over with, they moved into attacking Asuka and, you know, helping to make her softened up for Sasha to have her match later on in the night. So, I like this match between Asuka and Bayley. I thought it was very good, and so we're going to move on. The Raw Tag Team Championships were contested, Street Profits versus Garza and Andrade. And to be honest, I was checked out of this match. I didn't really care for it because we had seen it before, and it had been done so many times. But I was under the assumption that Garza and Andrade would be the ones to take the titles off of the Street Profits, but they kept those belts on the Street Profits. And I am worried because I feel like now they're going to drop them to somebody even bigger. And when they do, things are going to get real ugly. So I'm curious as to what they plan on doing with the tag team division. The tag team division itself is lacking on both brands. Well, for me, all three brands are lacking a tag team division, but we're hoping and praying that things will, you know, pick up speed as COVID-19, when they finally get COVID-19 under way, they can finally start to add new talent to the roster, build up the talent, you know, make things a little bit more fun again. And of course, maybe they will be able to get out of this funk that they've been in for the last couple of months. But overall, that tag team match was okay. I wasn't like, you know, mad about it. I actually liked the match. I just wasn't as invested in it as I should be. And I was glad the Street Profits won. I'm very happy for them. The Street Profits are one of my favorite tag teams. And for the better part of COVID-19, between the Street Profits and the Viking Raiders, the New Day, the Usos in the beginning, and of course on NXT you have Breezango and you have Santos Escobar and his crew. They've been pretty much holding down the tag team division. So things, you have Undisputed Era. So things are going to always look great, but they're doing their best to make things work in the time frame that they have. So the next match of the night was Sonya Deville versus Mandy Rose. And a no disqualification, loser leaves the WWE match. And this match really is one of the matches that I really felt bad for the girls. Sonya and Mandy's storyline was worth a decent ending to it. And whatever this maniac was planning on doing to Sonya Deville, he ruined an opportunity for her. So with her time off that she's taking, and I'm glad that she's taking time off because she went through a very, very traumatic experience, her and Mandy together. And when she comes back, you know, to wrestle, I hope they roll the red carpet out for her because she truly deserves it. Mandy Rose got the win, at this pay-per-view. I'm happy for Mandy. Mandy showed that she can wrestle, you know, has some skill, and that she is capable of defending herself when it comes time. I just need her to be a bit more aggressive. Mandy is a powerhouse. She has that power, and she is not using it. I don't know if WWE is holding her back or if she's holding herself back, but sometimes it almost looks like she's trying to think of what she's trying to do in the ring, and I need her to be more clean. I need her to be more polished. So I would highly recommend that she work with either Natalya or Mickey James. She needs to be put under someone who can give her the tutelage to hone her craft better, but utilize her power and brawn. I want her to be similar to what Raquel is in the ring. Raquel is clean. She's devastating, and she has a very, very simplistic moveset, but it is easy to see that her base core wrestling style is power and brute. And that is what I want from Mandy, because she can do it. Congratulations to Mandy Rose on her win at SummerSlam. And I hope when Sonya Deville returns that she comes back with full force and that she is in one of the best places mentally that she can be. And I really hope that they give her the push she deserves, because I see Sonya Deville as your next WWE SmackDown Women's Champion. I truly do. And when she comes back, if you didn't get to see it on WWEExclusive.com, I'm going to play this little clip for you, because I think when Sonya comes back, you're going to get a whole different character. She's not going to be Sonya Deville anymore. She's going to be somebody else.
Sonya, tonight you lost against Mandy Rose, and now you have to leave WWE. What's going through your mind? Like, what's next? Like, what's going on?
Do not call me that ever again.
The next match of the night was Dominic Mysterio versus Seth Rollins. Now, this match was a little bit shaky for me as well. I felt like this was not a street fight. A street fight is exactly what you call it. A street fight. This was not a street fight. This was literally a no DQ with kendo sticks and a chair. There was nothing else in this match to qualify it as a street fight. A street fight is just that, a street fight. Most of the time they wear plain clothes, they go out there and fight. Dominic had he had his ring gear on. He looked great. I love the way Dominic looked. I thought he looked great. I thought he was prepared. Dominic came and had his first match at SummerSlam, and he did really, really well. I'm very, very proud of him, as I'm sure his parents are, and I'm sure that WWE is happy with him as well. And outside of kayfabe, I'm sure Seth was very pleased with the way Dominic performed. Seth Rollins is Seth freaking Rollins, okay? He doesn't need any help. He does what he does. He's a great character in WWE as a heel or a face. Seth did awesome in this match. I just wanted it to be a street fight. I wanted it to be a brawl street fight. Now, did they fight? Sure. Did we get kendo sticks? Absolutely. Did we get even more emotion tacked into this match? Did we get drama? Did we get intrigue? Did we get mess? Yes, we got all of that, but we did not get what was promised, which was a street fight. Okay, you should have just named this a no disqualification match. Or you could have called it a false count anywhere, whatever. I don't care. Just don't call it a street fight when it wasn't a street fight. That was not a street fight. But I will say it was still a good match, though. I liked the match. I just wanted Dominic to get this win. Now, he didn't win, and his father had to watch him get beat. Meanwhile, Seth Rollins is one of the shadiest bitches I have ever seen in my life. This man was wearing Rey Mysterio's uniform in this match. This is one of Rey's gears. He took his gear concept and made his own. When he brought his ass out there, I'm sitting in the bed, I'm watching it. I was preparing for my live stream because I was getting ready to do a live, and I had to do a live with AT2. So I'm sitting here and I'm like, what does he have on? What is going on here? Why does he look so strong? He never wears purple. Seth Rollins sticks to minimalist colors. It's always black, white, navy, gray, silver. That's it. He doesn't go outside of that norm. Like, I've never seen him in anything else except for maybe red and yellow, maybe. Haven't seen him in blue that often, although I know he's been prone to do it. But usually he's in very minimalistic colors. So I was a little thrown off. I was a little taken aback by it. And I'm sitting here like, why does he have that on? And why is it so strange? Why does it look so familiar to me? And then somebody in my group chat posted this picture like he's wearing one of Ray's uniforms, one of his gears. And I'm like, bitch, you lying. And I'm like, that is just shady. It was so in your face. It was like, bitch, I got your son. I'm beating your son ass and I'm wearing your shit while I'm doing it. Like, I was like, hell no. Whoop his ass. Whoop his ass. I want his ass whipped. Do you understand me? I was so damn mad, child. And then Dominic was getting some get back. He was about to go after that boy's mama. His mama came out there. I was like, ooh, child. The only thing I wish was that Eddie Guerrero was alive to see this and be a part of it. Because I think he would have made it even better. Because, you know, that's his, like, that was his uncle and he loved him. And I think that Eddie being there and Ray being there would have just made this so much more emotionally charged. It just would have taken this over the top. So, and I miss Eddie Guerrero and I loved Eddie Guerrero. And rest easy, Eddie Guerrero. But I really wish that you would have been here to see Dominic grow up and be a wrestler. He's a wrestler now. And that's probably, I hope he's looking down and he's proud. But I really wish that he was here to see it. Anyway, that was my little side note before I start crying. Anyway, they handcuffed Ray and made him stand there and watch his son get beat by Seth Rollins. Payback is next week. And if I don't get any retribution for this, no pun intended, I am going to scream. They better give Ray and Dominic their just desserts. They better give it to them or I will bust WWE's ass. Okay? Because Dominic took a beating 2 weeks ago. A beating with those kendo sticks. And he did that shit and still came out there and fought that next week and then turned around yesterday and just whooped ass. Hell no. Hell no. They better give Dominic and Rey Mysterio some get back. Rey Mysterio, I quote unquote got pulled out. And he got his ass whooped twice by Seth Rollins. No, ma'am, Pam. He better get some get back or we gonna have beef. So they went back into championship bouts. And the rest of these matches on this card are gonna be championship matches. So Asuka and Sasha finally had their battle. And in this match, it was interesting because there was a lot of push and pull. Asuka had the upper hand. Sasha had the upper hand. You really enjoyed this match. It was the end that gave you a piece to Bayley and Sasha's feud starting. And of course, to Sasha and Asuka's feud ending. Now, there was a lot of, you know, submission hold breaking and countering and trying to, you know, keep out. And Asuka clearly was selling her pseudo knee injury in this particular match that she, you know, received courtesy of Sasha Banks and Bayley. But here's where things took a turn. It was towards the end of the match and Bayley tried to involve herself. And Asuka, of course, did her patented booty bump on the ropes. And Bayley did move Asuka out of the way, but she herself moved out of the way so she didn't take... Oh, Bayley moved Sasha. Sorry. Let me rephrase that. Bayley moved Sasha out of the way so she wouldn't take that force of that hit. But Bayley didn't take the hit for Sasha. Bayley moved. And she made it seem like she got injured when she really didn't. She just basically moved out the way and sat on the apron and then she slid down on the floor. I can't remember if Asuka hit her or not because that part is vague. But for the most part, Bayley was playing chicken. Like, there was nothing really wrong with Bayley. So they had a tit for tat, and Asuka was able to get her in the submission hold. She called for Bayley multiple times to help her, and Bayley was nowhere to be found. She was on the outside pretending she was so injured. And Sasha ultimately lost her Raw Women's Championship to, Sasha. Why did I say Asuka? Sasha ultimately ended up losing her Raw Women's Championship to Asuka via a tap. She didn't have no other choice but to tap. And Bayley came in the ring, but it was so late by the time she got in. And Sasha's just looking like, what is going on? Where were you? I helped you. You didn't help me. You know, that's the kind of look she was giving her. And it was pretty damning, if you ask me. Now, I don't know where this is going to lead, but I know for a fact that these two are going to drop those tag team titles at Payback. It only makes sense for them to no longer be tag team champions. Now, if they don't drop them at Payback, expect those tag team championships to be dropped somewhere between now and Survivor Series. Those titles have to be dropped in order for those two to fight the way they should. They have to change this dynamic of their relationship, and that's the only way that they can do it. It has to go back to the way that it was, where Bayley was the number one girl and Sasha was just her best friend. Now, we're going to see how that all works out, but I'm very happy for Asuka, and this will lead to a ton of opportunities for the women of Raw, where you have Shayna Baszler and her two best friends, Jessamine and Marina. You also have Bianca Belair there. You have Natalya, Lana, and of course, we got our girl, Mickie James, back and ready to roll. So one can only assume that there's a plethora of opportunities opening up a lot of doors, and we can't wait to see how this is all going to play out for everybody on Raw. But congratulations once again to Asuka for getting her Raw Women's Championship back and becoming the Queen of Raw once again. Now let's move into Drew McIntyre and Randy Orton's match, because this match I really liked. Randy Orton and Drew McIntyre have had a whirlwind of a feud. Of course, Randy is at his peak right now. This is one of the best versions of Randy Orton we've seen in a while. He's villainous, he's vicious, he's cruel, and everybody loves a good nasty heel. Now, in this particular case, Randy has gone back to his original characterization, just an older version of the Legend Killer, where he's been taking out legends left and right from Edge, Christian, Big Show, and even his own best bud, Ric Flair. Now, of course, he even went after Shawn Michaels last week, where Drew McIntyre took it very, very personally. This match was hard-hitting and it was brutal between the two of them, but where it fluttered and flattened out for me was the ending. This match ended with a roll-up. A roll-up from Drew McIntyre. Doing it throughout this whole match, every time they tried to hit their signature move, their signature finisher, it was countered. So Randy couldn't get his RKO off. You didn't see Drew try to take him out with the Claymore. But even then, these two guys have some of the best finishers in the WWE. And we didn't get to see that. So one can only assume that this feud isn't over and that this is going to happen again at Payback. And we might get a title change at Payback. Who knows? But Randy Orton is, of course, a calculating, cruel character. And in my mind, you could have hit him with the Claymore and he could have lost and still made this worthwhile as a Payback feud, where he attacks Drew and Drew might get some get back at Payback. They didn't give it enough mystery and intrigue after it was over. But I'm assuming that tonight on Monday Night Raw, you're going to see something happen to where it would be worthwhile to watch it this next Sunday when you get to Payback. So congratulations to Drew McIntyre for your win over Randy Orton. Randy Orton is one of the best WWE superstars. And of course, he's been one of the best wrestlers in the world. So congratulations to you for going over on a veteran, because he is a veteran, and solidifying your place at the top of the mountain, because you are the king of Monday Night Raw. You are the king because you have the belt of gold to prove so. So congratulations. And let's move on to the final bout and probably one of the biggest shockers of the night. We're talking about Braun Strowman versus Bray Wyatt. So this had a lot of emotion and intrigue in it from the beginning. If you've been following the story, which some people like and others don't, totally understand and get it. But at this point, this story has had so many twists and turns and added characters that we're just sitting here like, wow, okay, this has to be an amazing match tonight, right? Well, ladies and gents, we were let down. And I'll explain why. This match wasn't good. I'm going to be honest. For the most part, it was slow and it was just brutal, and I was ready for it to end. It was short, quite frankly, and I just thought there was going to be more to it than that, and there wasn't. There wasn't anything to it. There was nothing, you know, keeping you, you know, like, oh my God, this match is so good. And it's just because you have two people who really don't, I don't mean it by like that, so I'm going to say it a different way. Braun Strowman isn't the greatest wrestler, and of course his character isn't, you know, great enough, I guess you could say, to give you the best version of that. Now, a lot of people wanted him to go back to this Monster Among Men character, and of course, some people are happy with it and others aren't. I, on the other hand, am okay with a good story. And I think that this story is worth telling. And I think looking back on it, you'll enjoy it better. But this match is going to soil it. This is the last time you're going to see the Monster Among Men and Bray Wyatt in the ring together. And they just didn't deliver in this match. The greatest part about this match was Roman Reigns coming back and taking both of them out. And basically cussing them out as he berated and beat the living hell out of both of them. And I was shit sitting here like, what the fuck is happening? My first instinct was to just go, why are you here? You should be at home chillaxing until this COVID-19 shit is over with. You feel me? But he was not having that shit. That man was in some of the best shape that I've ever seen him in his entire WWE career. He looked great. And I love Roman. I've always loved Roman. I think that he is an amazing guy. But Jesus, he beat the hell out of Braun Strowman and Bray Wyatt. He took them down with ease. So this is going to lead to payback as well. And I'm excited. They said you'll never see it coming, and I honestly can say I did not expect that. That was a very good surprise for SummerSlam. Now, I'm going to leave everything else to you guys. I will tell you my overall thoughts of the show, and then I'm going to let you have it in the comment section below. I like SummerSlam. I thought SummerSlam was a very good show. I thought they did the best they could under the circumstances. And of course, the Thunderdome made it just so much better. So congratulations to WWE on another successful pay-per-view in my eyes. And thank you guys so much for listening. Comment below and let me know what you thought of the matches, how you felt about them, if they were great, if they were bad, if you thought the surprise of Roman Reigns returning. And one more thing I have to say before I get out of here and let you guys have it in the comments. This was the only time that a surprise happened on a big show like SummerSlam, and it wasn't ruined by the dirt sheets or people online. And that's what made this so much fun and even better. It's such a joy to be able to watch wrestling and be truly surprised by it. I don't always want to know everything. Some things I just want to be able to enjoy when it comes back and you get to finally watch it and enjoy it. Like, I am so happy that I was able to finally get a surprise out of wrestling and just have that genuine feeling of why I started watching wrestling from the beginning. Because it's just so much fun. And that is the very reason why I will always be a fan. So congratulations to WWE and all of the superstars, production, creative, all of you guys who were involved in the creation of SummerSlam this year. It was a very, very good show, and I was entertained. So thank you so much for being able to work through these terrible, as Charles Barkley says, these terrible times. We appreciate your hard work and your dedication, and I'm sure that you will be rewarded for your efforts, of course, and I can't wait to see what you have planned next. So as I said before, everybody who's listening, if you're within an earshot of my voice, make sure you guys rate, comment, and subscribe. Don't forget to hit that little tiny bell, letting you know that another video is going to be posted. However, thank you so much for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed this content, and I'll see you guys in my next one. Bye.